Fouad Ajami died on Sunday. He was 68 years old. His close friend, Leon Wieseltier of the New Republic magazine, said, "Nobody ever combined the virtues of idealism with the virtues of realism quite the way Fouad did. He believed devoutly in the possibility of freedom and democracy in the Arab world, but had no illusions whatsoever about the magnitude of the obstacles that stood in the way of his progressive dream." Ajami's first book in 1981, The Arab Predicament, spoke of dissent from the prevailing myths about Arab politics. He exposed the limitations of Marxism, nationalism, and Islamism, and called for various Arab societies to take responsibility for their own integrity and social progress. Fouad Ajami authored over 400 essays on Arab and Islamic politics, U.S. foreign policy, and international history. He was a prominent influence on the American understanding of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, the Bosnian War, and genocide. He advised high-ranking American officials on the war in Iraq and the so-called Arab Spring. Fouad Ajami believed that the Arab world should make peace with Israel and count the United States as its friend. He was born in a Lebanese village and became a proud American and argued eloquently for a strong global American presence. He was a longtime friend of this program and me, where he appeared more than 40 times. We remember him tonight with selections from conversations we had at this table over the years.
Have you been right about Iraq? And if not totally, how not?
That's a tough one. And it was via this desk you would be asked this question in this way. Have I been right about Iraq? I don't think anyone has been right about Iraq. I think Iraq has been full of surprises, and it surprised everyone. It surprised the people who prosecuted the war, the people who launched the war. It surprised the liberals who criticized the war. It surprised the hawks who thought that Iraq would redeem their best hopes. And I don't really, looking back on what I wrote about Iraq and looking back on the logic of the war and the logic that I subscribed to, you will remember, Charlie, I wasn't one of the people who were beating the drums of war. The war came. And I always say I was a 9/11 person. This is what I was working on. I was working on 9/11. I was working on the Arab attacks on America of 9/11. Then the Iraq war was launched. And I caught up with the war. And I followed the war. I went to Iraq because I didn't want to write about the war and think about the war from a distance. And I plunged myself into this war. And I thought I had some advantages, the advantages of language. Because here is this irony. We are deeply invested in the Arab world and deeply invested in Iraq. But many of our people, many of the people who write about the war, many of the people about the people who write for or against the war, know very little about that culture. I felt I had that advantage, at least. So I've just tried my best to understand this war. I'm sympathetic to the war. I think it's a noble effort. Our friend Bernard Henri Lévy once said that he thought that the war was morally right and politically wrong. And then he asked me, he said, "What would you say if you were to have a big soundbite about the war?" And I said, "It's a noble war. The question will be, will it be a noble success or a noble failure? Sometimes a noble effort can also fail." So I think we've tried to make sense of this war. And I have tried my best to just simply chronicle the war and chronicle the Iraqis, write about them. This book is full of Iraqis, whether it is something of an attempt at the portrait of Grand Ayatollah Sistani or this cleric or that man or this Kurdish poet. I've tried to follow the Iraqis and to write their lives. Charlie, as you know, on this one, I'm a total hawk. We owe the Arab world no apology for anything. We owe the Arab world no apology. For one, there were the terror attacks of 9/11, which emanated right from the heart of Arab society. We did this story over and over again a few years ago. These terror attacks were not the fringe attacks. They came right from the mainstream of Arab society. And then going into Iraq, when we upended the regime of Saddam Hussein, we overthrew a terrible tyranny that the Arab world in many ways had averted its gaze from all the terrible crimes of Saddam Hussein. The League of Arab States never uttered a word of sympathy for the Shia and Kurdish victims of Saddam Hussein. Whatever mistakes we've made in Iraq, they pale into insignificance when you compare them against the great crimes of the Saddam regime and the great crime of Arab silence. The fact that they were indifferent to the victims of Saddam Hussein. They shed no tear for them.
Saddam is gone.
Yes.
And now you have this extraordinary sectarian
yes.
violence.
Well, we can't prettify what's going on in Iraq. And we should understand that men are, I mean, there's a line in this book, I think, on the Shia resorting to violence, where I said men are not angels. Men are not angels. The Sunni Arabs in Iraq, and aided and abetted, by the way, by the forces of the Sunni Arabs in the Arab world around Iraq, they really had no apologies to offer. Indeed, they did the reverse, and they began this war against the Shia. And indeed, the irony was that many of the Sunni Arabs were spared sectarian revenge and spared sectarian killing. But we are where we are now. You're right. You are right. If you take a look at the Shia, suddenly now there's a balance of terror in Iraq, because the Shia, who are the victims, now have their own militias. The Badr Brigade and the Mahdi Army have come into the fight. And these are terrible forces. The forces of Muqtada Sadr are forces of darkness. They're forces of bigotry. They're kids without jobs. They're brigands. And they dabble in sectarian violence. But as that remarkable man, Jalal Talabani, the president of the country, said, some of the Sunni Arab leaders in Iraq bear responsibility for this violence against the Shia. They never reined in their community. They never understood that, having been the mainstay of the Saddam Hussein regime, you don't turn around and unleash a period of violence against the Shia.
I think there are a couple of images that frame this Iraq war for me. One, of course, April 9, 2003, the fall of the statue. And I hate to, again, refer to something related to you. We did a program from Washington that same very day about the fall of the statue of Saddam Hussein in Ferdus Square. That was one seminal moment for the Arabs. Another one was in December, some months later, December 13, I believe, when Saddam was flushed out of a spider hole. And the Arabs could see the fraud of this despot. They could see the banality, if you will, and the cowardice of evil. So I think it was not a very easy war, we know. And I think that my two colleagues have mapped out the problems. But I think there was something Michael said, which I sympathize with. And you could quote, there's a quotation I like from Ambassador Crocker, one of our wisest diplomats, who said, in the end, how we leave and what we leave behind would be much more important than how we came. We've been arguing about how we came, but it's really what we leave behind. That is the true test of this war.
Yeah, but I think that's what John was talking about.
Yes.
John Byrne. What we leave behind, not what we came for.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think, look, the war has been a terrible disappointment, I mean, in many ways. And you could, I suppose, we have given liberty to the majority of the Iraqi population. Yeah. I mean, there's no doubt about that.
So noble, in your judgment, failure or noble success?
It's a noble war. I don't think it's a catastrophic failure. I don't think it's a brilliant success. I mean, I happen to know, for example, Prime Minister Maliki, watching the lamentable leadership of this man, watching his, you know, the appetite has grown with the eating. He's become a real dictator. It's not exactly what those of us who thought well of the war would have expected from this war. But wars have these kinds of ends. They have these outcomes that people can't predict. They can't tell what will happen.
This is from Badr Shakir al-Sayyab,
right.
The Song of Rain, written in 1960. We spent year after year after year watching thunderous lightning clouds with no rain, and winds like storms which neither pass as a storm nor lie quiet. We sleep and wake up in fear of them.
That's the noblest. I'm glad you read this. That's the noblest poem. If you ask Iraqis and you say, you know, and the Iraqis.
Song of Rain.
Right. The Iraqis are very poetic people. There are two things the Iraqis are really good at in the Arab world. They are the pioneer poets, and they also are terrific at sculpture, which is an alien tradition to the Gulf and so on.
Sculpture.
And if you ask Iraqis and you say, what's the best poem a son of Iraq or a daughter of Iraq ever penned? They'll tell you Badr Shakir Sayyab, The Song of Rain, 1960, this very gifted man. And I open the book with it, and I close the book with it. It's about the Song of Rain, where he says, you know, every year, rain, we expect rain, and then every year, the people of Iraq still hunger. I mean, Iraq has been living on this expectation of deliverance. And there is a metaphor in this book, and this really, I think, is the unique part of this book, not the policy angle, where one of the great poets of Iraq says, he uses his own life as a metaphor for Iraq. He says he grew up in Najaf on a parched piece of ground, and the Euphrates River was achingly nearby. So there was always in Iraq the promise of a better future, a country that's rich with oil, rich with water, rich with agricultural soil, and yet it's wrecked.
And the question today remains whether an American led invasion and occupation will lead to the deliverance.
I think you've asked a very you've asked a very fundamental question. When you fly today, Charlie, from, because you can't fly to Baghdad directly, when you fly from Jordan, which is this rocky piece of ground that had nothing except governance, stability, the Hashemites give it stability, and you fly from Jordan to Baghdad, and here's this country, Iraq, which is rich and should be the one that's highly developed, or you fly from Kuwait to Iraq. Kuwaitis used to come and work in Iraq as day laborers before the age of oil. And you look at the condition of Iraq and compare it to the conditions of its neighbors, you can see what dictatorship did to Iraq. So we picked a very, very difficult laboratory for a very, very big experiment, I think with a lot of nobility built into this enterprise, and that's what this book tries to capture. And that's why I'm really delighted that you know, I hadn't really thought that Badr Shakir Sayyab would give, if you will, the real statement. You know, the song of rain, you're waiting for rain and you're waiting for deliverance. And the gift comes from America. It's the foreigner's gift. And people don't like the gift handed by foreigners. That's hence the ambivalence written into this title.
Let's face it, the regime has no script. The opponents in the street have no script. We're playing it by ear. And when you study all revolutions, the element of contingency, of accident, a young man in a forlorn town in Tunisia sets himself on fire, and the regional order of the autocrats itself is in danger.
And history changes. History
changes. Look, when you said something about the Mubarak strategy, you ask, I smiled. I'm reminded of an Egyptian joke, and the Egyptians were funny before Mubarak. After Mubarak, the humor left the land. And it is about when Mubarak became president, he took a ride with his driver, and he asked the driver, he said, he came to a crossroad, and the driver said, Ya Rais, Mr. President, what do I do? He said, tell me, which way did Nasser used to turn? He said, always to the left. He said, and Sadat? He said, always to the right. He said, okay, don't move. So, don't move. This is the Mubarak strategy, is don't move. Stiff anyone who comes to you with demands. And look at Mubarak. He's been there through five American presidents, right? From the days of Ronald Reagan's. And we've always talked about pushing him to reform and so on. Mubarak is a survivor and a wily man, and he would hope that he could somehow ride out the storm. My guess is a variation on what Neil said. The army now calls the shots. The pharaonic system of Hosni Mubarak and clan is fallen. And if he stays at the good grace of the army.
Fouad Ajami, who died at age 68.